Today I'm beginning the process of a complete overhaul of my bookshelves. When I moved to the new place, I was just happy to put my books on the shelves, and I didn't really think too much other than very broad strokes where they were going. But now that I'm settled in, and now that I've gotten quite a few new books, I really want to get everything organized and get rid of the ones that I will never read, and actually find out how many books I've been lugging around from dorm room to dorm room. Today, we are just unloading the bookshelves. The entire process was completed over the course of 2 days, and while I'm unloading all of my shelves, I'm going to be talking about the past year in books. I absolutely love data analysis, and that's something that I do for my job, so I did a little bit of amateur data analysis for today. Now, from my title, you can see that I've read 365 books in 365 days, but in reality, that number is actually slightly off. I've read 377 books in 365 days. Title sounded cooler when I said 365. Overall, I've read my way across 86,000 pages. And on average, each month, I read about 31 books. And my average book length was around 222 pages. It's honestly the most I've ever read, and as much fun as it was, this is probably not an achievement I'm going to look to repeat. It was time consuming. A lot of people ask, how can I read so much? Well, I do have a 40-minute bus commute, so typically I'll spend about 7 hours per week reading physical copies of books on the bus. I also try to read a half hour each night before bed, which is another couple hours. I'm also an avid audiobook fan and will listen to them on 2 to 3x speed, depending on whether or not there's an accent, while I'm getting ready for the day, cleaning around the house, and when working on figures for my work. And I can end up listening to upwards of an audiobook a day. Now, I'm not going to get into whether or not audiobooks count as real books. To me, they do, because at the end of the day, you're coming away with a new story, one that you have not heard before. And then for the purposes of these stats, I am counting audiobooks in page numbers as well, because I didn't want to get into figuring out how many hours I listened to and like adding all of that up separately. So moving on to stats, in case you're curious, I got these stats by sorting through my books onto Goodreads. Goodreads is an online book reviewing community, and I believe it's one of the largest, if not the largest, out there. I joined Goodreads back in September of 2017, and since then I've had so much fun figuring out my book stats and watching the different numbers change as I read more and more. So starting off, we're going to look at book format. Of the total books I've read, a majority were physical copies, but only just barely. As much as I love reading physical copies, I do adore the convenience of my Kindle when I'm out on long trips or listening to audiobooks. Now, from there, I try to break down into specific categories. So, what type of digital media was I consuming? What type of physical copy did I have? And unsurprisingly, audiobooks accounted for a hefty chunk. I don't actually own that many audiobooks in general, so I'm very picky about which ones I have a physical copy of. I currently own the Harry Potter series, Laura Ingalls Wilder, and Chronicles of Narnia on audiobook, and I listen to Laura and Harry every single year. And even though I absolutely adore audiobooks, I cannot afford my audiobook addiction here. So all of the other audiobooks on there are actually from my digital library, which is something that I 110% love. I listen via Overdrive and the Libby app. It is honestly something that has changed my life. So then taking all of those books again, I broke it down based off of age range, and that would be the intended age range of the books. Now, I can already see some people getting really technical with me and saying that reading children's books to reach a goal of 365 books in 365 days is cheating. However, I never actually started the year with that goal in mind. And it was only in December when I realized that I was about 40 books shy of 365 that I really kicked my reading into high gear. So naturally, what I do is I just pull from a variety of age ranges. I read what I want, when I want. And I was never in that camp where you need to read your age. When I was younger, I loved reading grown-up books, and now that I'm an adult, I really enjoy picking up books intended for a younger audience. I like the simplicity of it and the pure fun that those books provide. Plus, I need to keep up on trends. Someday there's gonna be little Reeds running around, And could you imagine the embarrassment if I had absolutely no idea what sort of books were cool for the kids to read? Tragic. So from there, I took the adult age group, which was my largest age group, and I subdivided it based off of the genre. So this is a little bit subjective because I categorized this based off of the biggest genre of the book that I saw when I was reading it. So for example, if I was reading a horror comedy book, if I felt more scared rather than feeling like I was about to laugh, I categorized it as horror. So when I was making this, I thought I would see some really cool trends regarding which book I tended to gravitate to, but for the most part, it seems pretty well spread out. I'm generally not a fan of historical fiction, but this year it seems like I did read quite a few of them. I did read Daisy Jones and the Six, and that one was an absolute stunner. And this year was the first year I was actually terrified by a book. So shout out to The Return. It's coming out soon, and wow, that one was terrifying. Mystery was another one that I didn't think I'd have that many, but it seems like I had a few. And those ones I mostly read cozy mysteries. Meet Me at the Cupcake Café was a really cute one if you're looking for like that cute cozy. And then the biggest category is fiction and nonfiction, and that's kind of where I threw the ones where I wasn't sure, where they didn't seem to fit any of the other categories perfectly well. From there, I started to sort the books based off of their origins, and by origins, I mean like how they came into my life. As a quick clarification from the chart, gift means it was given to me by a friend or family member. Owned means that I have a copy in my house and reread it. Bought means that I bought it in 2019 and read it the same year. Physical library, obvious. Received to review meant that it was sent to me. Digital library was the library that I was talking about earlier where I get my audiobooks. Unsurprisingly, the biggest category is both digital library and received to review. I honestly felt like received to review was going to be even larger just because I always feel like I'm so behind on reading and reviewing books. Even though it only made up 49% of my total reading for the year, that's still 186 books that I read for someone else. So then I took the 86 books that I received to review and split it up based off of indie, self-publishing, or publishing companies. Now I've always been a huge supporter of indie and self-published authors, so it's kind of fun to see that the data supports that. On average, I read a self-published or indie published book once every 3 days this year. So part of me wanted to go in and figure out what percentage were indie and what percentage were self-published. But the differences can be so minute that it would require me to look up each and every single and do some background research on whether or not I can categorize it as indie or self-pub. So I just threw up my hands at that one. So from there, I took the publisher category and broke it up based off of who sent me their books this year. It was a little bit difficult to figure out which company sent me which book because a lot of the larger publishing companies are umbrella companies. For example, Berkeley also publishes Ace Books. So sometimes I got sent books from the parent, sometimes I got them sent from the umbrella, which makes keeping track a little bit difficult. As far as how I get all these books, I think I might do a separate video on that. Honestly, I just have a few contacts that I check in with every few months to see what books they like reviewed and make my selection from what they send me. Otherwise, publishing companies either contact me via my website or my Goodreads page. Berkeley Publishing was the very first company that ever asked me to review for them, and they always will hold a special place in my heart for that. I remember being so excited and so overwhelmed by the idea that someone would actually want me to read a copy of their book. Familius Publishing is a company that I started working with this year, and they're absolutely lovely. They're such a sweet, kind company, and I really enjoy reading and reviewing for them. They also send me quite a few books, but most of them are children's to middle age group. So while they sent me a lot, they were rather quick reads. And then finally, we're gonna look at my month by month breakdown of the book. For this one, I use Goodreads stats page because they also conveniently keep track of what books I read each month, as well as the page count. So you might notice right away for my books read by month that I didn't read a book a day according to this distribution. And honestly, I don't think I could with school. I've mentioned it quite a bit, but I am a graduate student, and my free time and availability for reading and reviewing really does ebb and flow based off of the school year, which was kind of cool to see with the book trend. So as you can see right away, I read quite a bit in January, February, March, but it dropped off really sharply in April and May. And that's when my classes were really ramping up and when I had to spend a lot of time at work as well. The same drop can be seen in August, where there was a grant to do, and I was also prepping for the fall semester, and I just didn't have as much time to read books. Now, you might be wondering about the elephant in the room, which would be December. So once I hit December 15th or so, I was actually hovering around 320, and I realized that I was only 40 books away from 365. And I was really like excited by that concept, and I really wanted to push myself and see if I could actually hit that goal. At the same time, I had a lot of children's and middle grade books that were sent to me from indie and self-published authors. And honestly, like once that winter vacation hit, I shut myself in my room and just powered through a ton. It was honestly exhilarating to add these books onto Goodreads and see that number just climb higher and higher. And then when I hit 365, it was exciting. Like, I ran out to tell Squamish and we went on like such a long walk to celebrate. So then from there, I broke down based off of how many pages I read per month. And unsurprisingly, we see the same trend where in April and May and August, there's a significant decrease in the number of pages. December has an uptick, but not as high as you would expect considering how many books I read, purely because like I did hit a lot of children's and middle grade books. And then from there, I looked at how many pages per book I read, and I took the total number of pages in a single month and divided it by the number of books per that month. And I honestly didn't really think I would see a trend because there's not really a month where I actively decide to only read 600 plus page books or a month where I decide to read only children's board books. Though I did notice December, we went from hovering around 250 or so pages per book to around 150. And yeah, I see that because I read around 80-ish books, 10,000-ish pages, but a lot of those books were for younger audiences. So it brought down my average by a little bit. And then I think we have a little bit more time left for this. I'm still working on sorting all of the books over there. So I'm going to talk a little bit about like my highlights from each month. For January, I'm going to start off with a self-published shout-out. Dragon Speaker was an excellent book. It really took me by surprise, and it was a indie self-published book sent to me, and it had a really fun journey. I loved the way the dragons were portrayed in that book. Really enjoyed it. February, A Man Called Ove. And I know it's supposed to be Uva because I listened to the audiobook, but it looks so much like Ove that I just went with Ove. This one is about an old man who lost his wife and he's really struggling to find himself. This one does get a little bit dark, but it has a very good humanizing element to it and it ends up making you laugh despite the seriousness of the situation. So March, we're hitting another self-pub shout out, Buy My Book by John. And when I read the book, I loved how wild it was. Like there were trends back and forth. Each chapter was its own unique experience. And I thought it was a lot of fun. April, my friend told me that I had to drop everything and read P.S. I Still Love You. And she was right. It was amazing. P.S. I Love You was just really sweet and it hit the comedy just right for me. It was a light-hearted modern book and I don't really pick those up too often. I always like a little paranormal or fantasy element, but this one hit me just right and I absolutely loved it. May, I was shopping for my mother's birthday present and I found Owls, Our Most Enchanting Birds, and I immediately bought it for her. I love the illustrations and I love the way the author did the owls for this book because they're just, he gives you like the quirkiest little habits of the owls and it just ends up being so freaking cute that I loved it. June, hitting out with a self-published shout out, Margin Play. This one was actually not sent to me. This one I saw the author on Goodreads. And I was really intrigued by his books and I picked it up for myself. It's a really well thought out detective mystery, but this one absolutely exceeded expectations. And it was so good that I bought the second one and I read it, and it's also absolutely excellent. So July, I read Chemistry at the suggestion of one of my lab mates, and it really perfectly encapsulates that feeling of like hopelessness that everyone seems to feel once they hit grad school. Like, grad school is difficult, and I would say there's 110% chance that you're gonna feel absolutely awful at times because your research isn't working, your papers aren't getting published, it feels like you're going nowhere. And this book really encapsulates that feeling. August, I read The Lost Causes of Bleak Creek. I got to meet the authors for this one, and it was so much fun to talk to them about their book and get kind of like an insider information about it. September, I read One Star Review. So for the premise of this one, there is an author, she's writing these absolutely famous books, and then there's a reviewer who writes a really mean one-star review that the author decides to do something about it. So this one ended up being a lot of fun for me, and what I really noticed was that the reviews that were written about this author's work didn't seem kill-worthy for me. So I wrote an entirely fake review based off a fake book within one-star review. The actual author of the book saw that. He ended up contacting me about playing a role in the next book of that series, specifically as a reviewer who wrote a one-star review. So I'm going to have a separate video about that, but here it is for now. If you're kind of curious what book I'm talking about, there it is. Moving on to October, I was sent The Little Women Cookbook. I'm always a huge fan of anything Little Women-ish. So when the authors contacted me to do a review of the cookbook, I immediately jumped on that. So hitting up November, the Munchy Munchy cookbook was sent to me by Familius, and that one was so fun. I know that I'm an adult, but I love that there are little characters running around in the cookbook making mischief, and the recipes were things that I hadn't thought to do. And it really kind of enhanced my own cooking. Jane Doe, that one was one of the very first buddy reads that I did with Tucker the Reader. And it was all about this girl who has very limited emotions because of a past trauma. Her friend committed suicide because of the man she was with. Like, he drove her to kill herself. And Jane Doe, not being held back by emotions, decides to get her revenge in the most horrifying way possible to this man. So I really liked it, and it was a lot of fun to do a buddy read with it. And then in December, we read one of my favorites, Sharp Objects by Gillian Flynn. There's something about that one. Every few years, I just want to read it again. And like, enough time has passed that it's almost like I'm reading it for the first time, where I get a lot of that enjoyment. And that's also when I read The Return, which I talked about earlier in this video, but giving it another shout out does not hurt, because wow, I loved it. Alright, so that is my year in review. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe, like, comment, let me know what your book stats are. I'm really curious. Have a great day.